In the depths of the Triassic era, there was a giant-headed predator that was a genuine monster with a body longer than a vehicle and weight comparable to a small elephant. Its thick and scaly skin served as an almost impregnable defense against any potential attackers. It appeared to be controlled by a malicious spirit, as its eyes shone with a sinister crimson light. It was Erythrosuchus's domain. Around 250 million years ago, a large predatory archosaur named Erythrosuchus inhabited the Earth. It belonged to the group known as the Rauisuchians, which predated dinosaurs and ruled the ecology at the same time as apex predators. A powerful predator, Erythrosuchus had a body length of up to 20 feet and weighed about 500 kilograms. Its gigantic, elongated head, which could reach a length of 3 feet and made up nearly a third of its entire body length, was its most distinguishing characteristic. Erythrosuchus had a massively strengthened cranium with a broad, deep snout loaded with numerous sharp teeth, some of which may reach a length of 10 centimeters. Its jaws were so powerful that they could readily crush the bones of its prey with just one bite. Erythrosuchus's robust, stocky body and massively muscled neck were crucial adaptations for its position as the top predator in the Triassic ecology. These characteristics gave the animal the power and agility required to take down enormous prey and protect itself from other predators. Erythrosuchus likely used its powerful neck to grab hold of its prey, giving it a firm grip that enabled it to immobilize its prey. Erythrosuchus would have had unusually powerful neck muscles that enabled it to grip its prey firmly and with great force. But this creature's intelligence was perhaps its most horrifying feature. It was able to plan and carry out intricate hunting maneuvers with brutal effectiveness, unlike most other predators of its day. Now let's talk about the climate conditions while they existed and their habitat. The Earth was a drastically different place back when Erythrosuchus lived than it is today. This was the early Triassic epoch, which came after the Permian-Triassic extinction catastrophe, the biggest mass extinction in the history of life on Earth. Over 90% of marine species and over 70% of terrestrial species were wiped out by this catastrophic event, including many of the predominant reptile groups of the time. Early Triassic climates were often hot and dry, with vast deserts encompassing most of the continent. But there were also significant wetlands and swamp habitats, especially close to the coast and in low-lying regions. Fish, amphibians, and reptiles that resemble crocodiles were just a few of the aquatic and semi-aquatic creatures that found these wetlands to be crucial homes. The ecosystems of the time were still in a state of upheaval, as the Earth was still working to recover from the consequences of the mass extinction. This provided a chance for new animal species to emerge and fill the ecological gaps left by the extinction. One of these new groups of carnivores that emerged in the early Triassic was Erythrosuchus, which was well adapted to the difficult environment of the time. Being the terrestrial predator, Erythrosuchus probably lived in a variety of habitats throughout the early Triassic landscape. It could thrive in a variety of settings, including desert and wetland ecosystems. The early Triassic world's coastal regions were one possible Erythrosuchus habitat. Sea levels were increasing at the time, and a lot of low-lying land was submerged in water. Large-scale wetlands, mangrove forests, and estuaries would have existed in these regions, serving as vital habitats for a range of aquatic and semi-aquatic creatures, including fish, amphibians, and reptiles that resemble crocodiles. In these marsh habitats, Erythrosuchus would have been well suited for hunting, because it could ambush its victims from the cover of plants or wait for them to approach the water's edge to drink. Erythrosuchus may have lived in arid, drier ecosystems like deserts and scrublands in addition to wetland habitats. Larger animals would have had a harder time surviving in these habitats, but Erythrosuchus was well suited to the harsh environments of these areas thanks to its hard, scaly skin, which protected it from the sun, and its powerful jaws, which allowed it to hunt effectively among the scant foliage. Well, do you know what food they ate to survive? It is most likely that Erythrosuchus was a predator with a diet primarily composed of other animals based on the morphology of its skull and teeth. It was equipped with strong jaws and pointed serrated teeth that were perfect for tearing apart the flesh of its prey. Its diet included a variety of prey species, including other reptiles, early mammals, and amphibians. Erythrosuchus would have been one of the top predators in its ecosystem. Erythrosuchus may have even been capable of capturing larger prey, including smaller dinosaurs or other archosaurs, according to some scientists. Erythrosuchus was an opportunistic hunter, and it would have been able to modify its diet to meet the availability of prey in its environment based on the form and structure of its teeth. This would have been crucial during the early Triassic period, which experienced significant ecological upheaval and change as numerous new animal species evolved and filled the ecological niches created by the huge extinction catastrophe that came before it. Though due to the rarity and incompleteness of the Erythrosuchus' fossils, as well as the paucity of data indicating how this animal interacted with other members of its own species or other animals, there is currently very little knowledge on the social behavior of this species. But scientists claim that because of its enormous size, strong jaws, and intimidating body armor, Erythrosuchus was probably a solitary predator that hunted and consumed prey by himself rather than in a flock or group. Its physical hunting abilities, such as its powerful jaws and teeth, would have allowed it to kill target animals by itself. Additionally, it's conceivable that Erythrosuchus was territorial, guarding a particular habitat from intruders or potential rivals. Many contemporary reptiles exhibit this behavior, which may have given Erythrosuchus continued access to vital resources like water or prey animals. Erythrosuchus most likely used internal fertilization, in which the male places sperm inside the female's reproductive system like many contemporary reptiles do. In contrast, external fertilization takes place outside the female's body and involves the male fertilizing the female's eggs. Furthermore, it is likely that Erythrosuchus produced eggs rather than live young. This is based on the architecture of its hips, which indicates that it may have had a small pelvic entrance, making it challenging to give birth to enormous progeny. Given its size, Erythrosuchus most likely had a lengthy gestation period and may have laid a few number of enormous eggs as opposed to many smaller ones. Smaller reptiles, on the other hand, frequently lay a large number of tiny eggs all at once. It is believed that a number of environmental changes that took place in the late early Triassic epoch contributed to the extinction of Erythrosuchus. The temperature and biological circumstances were changing, and the Earth was recuperating from a significant mass extinction catastrophe. The appearance of new, more specialized predators that were better adapted to the shifting ecological conditions was likely one of the main factors that led to Erythrosuchus' extinction. Erythrosuchus might have lost out to more specialized predators that were better equipped to exploit particular ecological niches when the ecosystem healed and new species emerged. The extinction of Erythrosuchus was most likely caused by a combination of environmental conditions. There were times of high heat and aridity followed by cooler, wetter periods throughout the late early Triassic epoch, which saw a substantial change in climate. The availability of resources like food and water would have been significantly impacted by these climate changes, which may have made it more challenging for giant carnivores like Erythrosuchus to thrive. Also conceivable is the possibility that a catastrophic occurrence, like a volcanic eruption or asteroid impact, directly affected Erythrosuchus. The extinction of many species, including Erythrosuchus, may have resulted from such events, even if there is no direct evidence to support this. They may have had a huge impact on the ecology at the time. So this was all about the giant-headed monster predator of the Triassic period, Erythrosuchus. If you want to get more such updates, hit the bell icon and subscribe to this channel. Also, let us know in the comments section how you find it. By knowing about unique species, we get an idea of how the world, climate, and wilderness was in historic times. We get to know about several new concepts we never knew ever existed. Did you know that long before the mammals began to roam the earth and birds took to the skies, the Triassic period saw the emergence of powerful creatures that came to rule the world? Click the video on your screen to know more about it.